Good evening, students. Today we are going to continue the last session, which was we started the instruction set, and we have been discussing about the instruction set from the last 2-3 classes. So in this session, we are going to start about the string instruction. We are going to talk about the string instructions as well as the branch control instructions and all those things. Okay. So let us go to the string instructions. Okay. Let us go to the string instructions. So the string instructions are used to perform the string related operations like copying the string, storing the string, loading the string, everything. But we know that the string related information is going to be stored inside the extra segment. The string related information is going to be stored in the extra segment. We are having the four segments now: code segment for storing the code, that is the opcode, and data segment for holding the data, stack segment for holding the data during the execution of the program, and what is that next one is the extra segment, which is used for holding the data as well as the string information. Data as well as the string information. So here we are having a set of instructions which are performing the string related operation. String related operation. So remember, ma, here whatever the move operation, compare operation, store, load operation, store operation, what we are doing, all those operations are going to be done with respect to the data segment information as well as the extra segment information. Data segment as well as the extra segment. So what we do is we'll go to the string instructions. First one is the move. We'll go with the move. After that we'll go with the compare, and after that we'll go with the LD, load, store, all those things. So let us go for the move instruction. Okay. So let us go for the move instruction. So here we are having one instruction called as a move instruction, or move s. Okay, now. So move s is nothing but move the string. Move s is nothing but the move the string. So I would like to move the string in the byte format. I would like to move the string in the byte format. The syntax for this one is whatever the move instructions which we have seen in the data transfer case. Same operation is going to be done by the move sb instruction. Means we are having the destination. We are having the destination comma source. We are having the destination comma source. In this case, when we are performing the move sb is nothing but move the string in the byte format. Actually, string is a group of characters, and each character is going to be stored in the form of the ASCII value. That ASCII information is going to be stored inside the one of the segment. Inside one of the segment. Here, when we are using the move sb instruction, move sb says that move the string information in the byte format, not in the word format. It is going to be the byte format. And that too, the information is going to be moved from the source into the destination. Remember, ma, here the source is always the data segment. Source is always the data segment. What is the physical address for the data segment? DS colon SI. All of us know this one, right? 20-bit physical address is going to be represented by the DS colon SI for the data segment. DS colon SI for the data segment. And destination is always extra segment. ES colon DI. This is a physical address representation. Okay, now. So source is nothing but we are reading the data. We are reading the string information from the data segment, which is specified. From which address we started, from which memory location onwards we are reading the information, that is going to be specified by this particular, 20-bit physical address format. This particular 20-bit physical address format means we are reading the data from the data segment into the, and we are copying, reading and storing that information inside the extra segment. That information inside the extra segment. See, ma, here as I said, string is nothing but it is a group of characters. Each character is having one ASCII value. Let us suppose I would like to copy one string whose name is the MSc. Let us take MSc. Otherwise, let us take the title of our subject, which is nothing but the physics. So MSc physics is there. Now let me take the physics. So physics is a group of characters. So for each and every character, we are having one ASCII value, and that ASCII value is going to be stored. Each character ASCII value is going to be stored in the consecutive memory locations. Each character ASCII value is going to be stored inside the memory in the consecutive memory locations. When you would like to read one word, physics, so it is a group of character, na? it is a group of character na, all those characters should be read. Means I would like to read one physics word which is there in the data segment. From the data segment into the extra segment means here the microprocessor need to perform the reading the character information from the source into the destination. From the source into the destination. So physics means, let me take the physics over here. So we are having the physics now. So how many characters we have? Seven characters. Physics is nothing but it is a group of seven characters. And these seven characters are stored in the consecutive memory locations. As I said, assume that this is a source and this source is available in the data segment. And this information should be read from the data segment into the extra segment. This information should be copied. As per this statement, we are saying that copy the source information into the destination. Source is nothing but the data segment. Destination is nothing but the extra segment. And that to what kind of word we are interested to copy? Physics. But physics is a group of characters. Okay, now. So here, when you are asking the microprocessor to copy the physics word from the source into the destination, you are supposed to mention that, see here we are having the MOVESB. MOVESB is nothing but move the string in the byte format. So how many bytes means for each character we are having one ASCII value. That ASCII value is equal to the byte. Actually, it is a 7-bit, but we are going to reform that one into the 8-bit format. Okay, now. So each character means P is having one ASCII value, H is having its own ASCII value, Y is having its own ASCII value, and so on to the S. Up to the S, we are having the ASCII values. Okay, now. So if you want to read one word from the source into the destination, how many ASCII values we are supposed to read? 7 ASCII values. Means 7 bytes of information should be transferred from the source into the destination. That is nothing but from the data segment into the extra segment. Okay, now when you are writing this instruction, MOVESB space destination comma source, without knowing to you the default, how many times you would like to repeat this operation? See, it is a group of characters, na? Group physics is nothing but group of characters. How many times you are supposed to perform the read operation? Every time it is performing the byte read operation only. So how many times you are supposed to perform? 7 times. Okay, now. So 7 times MOVESB is nothing but move the string byte instruction should be get executed first 7 times in order to copy the 7 characters as a word from the source into the destination. Now the question comes that when we are writing the instruction like this, when we are writing the syntax MOVESB space destination comma source, are we mentioning to the microcontroller explicitly that how many times this one should get executed? We are not mentioning. Okay, now. So if you are not mentioning anything, obviously only one character is going to be read from the source into the destination. Only one character is going to be copied from the source and stored inside the destination. But how many times we are interested to, what is our word we are interested to copy? Which is a physics word. Physics word is a group of 7 characters. Means 7 bytes need to be transferred from the source into the destination. 7 bytes should be transferred from the source into the destination. So in order to mention explicitly that, how many times this operation should get executed? How many times this operation should get executed? For that, what you are supposed to do means you are supposed to load the counter register with the count. Okay, now. How many bytes actually here we are having? 7 bytes. Okay, now. 7 characters are there. For each character, we have one ASCII value which is equal to the 1 byte. Okay, now. So 7 times we are supposed to copy the information from the source into the destination. Okay, now. So in order to perform that operation, in order to explicitly mention this information, means 7 times this instruction should get executed. In order to inform that information to the microprocessor, what we are supposed to do means we are supposed to use the counter register to hold the count value. How many times this instruction should get executed? We are supposed to have the counter register to hold the count. How many times this particular MOVESB instruction should get executed? Because of that, I am going to write the instruction. Means I am going to fill the counter register with the 0007H instruction. I am going to save this one with the means I am going to save my value. This value, whatever the value we are having, this value 07, because the characters are 7 now. So 7 is going to be given as a count to the counter register. Now, if you want to make use of this instruction for 7 times, let me take the new one because it is a. So just remember this point. the move SB and the source always the destination. Data segment and the destination is always the extra segment. And we are interested to read the physics word. Okay, we are interested to read the physics word. I'm just erasing this. Okay, so let me take this one. Okay, now so here we are interested to read the physics word. Now, so what I'm going to do means I'm going to write the instruction with like this. So here first I'll fill my counter register with how many characters, how many ASCII values you would like to copy from the data segment into the extra segment. After that, I'm going to use one REP instruction, which is a repeat instruction. We are having the REPZ, REP, REP and Z. Repeat until zero. Repeat non-zero, until the non-zero. Okay, now. But if you are getting confused with that, just you can skip that one. But in order to repeat the what is that instruction, that move instruction is there now. We are interested to read the copy. What is that value now? So here I'll do one thing. Okay, move. No. Wait a minute. Give me some time. Okay, move. CX. Okay, instead of writing the move over here, I'll write move over here. Move CX comma 0007H followed by what I'll do is I'll take this one later. Over here I'm going to take my move SB instruction. Move SB space destination comma source now. So I'm just writing the destination comma source. So if you want, you can mention the entire thing. But I'm just writing in the syntax format, destination comma source. Now, how many times, what is our source actually? What is our word we are interested to copy? I'm just taking the red mark, which is a physics, right? We are interested in the physics, right? So in order to read the 7 bytes from the source into the destination, we are taking the counter register. Na? So whenever you are using this instruction, which is a group of 7 characters, and in order to on every execution, it is reading only the 1 character. But how many times, in order to finish one word, how many times we are supposed to repeat this operation? 7 times. So I'm going to precede this instruction with the REP. Okay, repeat instruction. So I'm just using the repeat instruction. I'll take over here. I'm expecting that you are able to see this one. REP. So I'm not writing the colon actually. So here colon should be there. If I'm writing the colon, it is going to be overwritten. So that's why I took the different color. So REP. If I'm using the REP instruction just before this one, then this instruction, whatever the instruction we are having, this instruction got executed by count number of times, CX times. How many times? 7 times. It is going to be executed 7 times. Okay. So as it is executing 7 times, 7 characters are going to be copied from the source into the destination. Source is nothing but the data segment. Destination is nothing but the extra segment. Source is nothing but the data segment. Destination is nothing but the extra segment. So if you realize this concept, same thing is there for the move SW. Okay, now so means we have one more instruction called. So this is another example. So here, I think you realize this concept, right? In order to read the 7 characters, we are taking the counter register and we are preceding this instruction with the REP. So this instruction is concentrating on the CX value. Means this instruction get executed repeatedly by the CX times, means 7 times. So 7 times means on every copying operation, it is copying one character. Total physics is going to be copied from the source into the destination. Let us see another kind of the instruction what we are having. So move, we are having one more instruction called as a move SB, right? Move SW. Previously it was the SB, now it is a SW. Means we are interested to copy the information in terms of the word format, not in the byte format. Byte format means 1-1 memory location is going to be read. Word format means 2-2 memory locations are going to be read in the consecutive memory locations format. That is about the move SW. We are having the move S, move the string information, move the string in the byte format, move the string in the word format. Move the string in the word format. This is about the move instructions with respect to the strings. Move instructions with respect to the strings. So after that, we are having compare instructions. So before going to the compare instruction, let us concentrate on the load instruction. Load instruction means whatever the string we are having, that string information is going to be loaded from the top of the data segment into the accumulator register. Means source is going to be over here. In this case, the source is going to be the source is always the data segment, which is a DS colon. DS colon SI. And in this case, the destination is going to be the AL, accumulator layer. Okay. Now, so if you are taking the byte information or the load S instruction, load S is nothing but load the string information. So load SW is nothing but load the content from this particular memory location, which is specified by the DS colon SN. From that particular memory location, load one byte of information into the AL. So means AL is going to be the destination. So means you are copying the information from, or sorry, it is not the copying, it is a loading operation, as the name suggests. So we are loading the information from the data segment into the accumulator lower byte. If at all we are taking the load as W, it is going to be the 16-bit number. So when you are taking the 16-bit number, instead of the AX, we are going to have the, sorry, instead of AL, we are going to have the AX. Now, the information is going to be read, loaded from the data segment into the AX register in the 16-bit format. Okay. So let us go for the store instruction. Store instruction means storing the, it is going to be the reverse one. Now, in this case, so the reverse one is nothing but now the source is going to be, oops, I thought it is a label, but it is not. Okay. We are interested in the store instruction. In case of the store, source is going to be the AL. Source is going to be the AL register or AX register. Source is going to be the AL or AX. AL means byte information, AX means word information. AL is byte information, AX is word information. What about the destination? Now the destination is going to be, I'll do one thing over here, I'll write over here. Now the destination is going to be the, destination is nothing but, it is a ES colon DI. Extra segment is the destination. In this set of instructions, during the store operation, source is going to be the AL or AX, that depends on the byte or the word information, and destination is going to be the ES colon DI. Okay, so it is a extra segment. Okay, now scanning operation means comparison operation. Comparing the, in this case, in the scan string operation, scan string operation, we are interested to check it out. Whether expected word is there or not. In order to do that operation, we are using the scanning operation, and we are having the compare operation. Compare operation is nothing but this compare instruction is going to be compares the two bytes or two word format information, one from the data segment, another from the extra segment. So in this case also, source is going to be the, so in the, during the compare operation, let me go back, during the compare operation, so source is going to be the, sorry, source is the DS colon SI, destination is the, obviously, it is going to be the ES colon D. Okay, so this is what we are having. Means compare operation is nothing but which compares the two bytes of information or two strings which are going to be specified, one by the data segment, another by the extra segment. Comparing the two strings between the stored in the data segment as well as the extra segment. Okay, now we'll see the compare instructions in the about the compare instruction in detail as we move on to the branch control instructions. Okay, now so this is about the string information. Okay, so give me some time. Wait a minute, ma. Give me some time, ma'am, because I don't know the time. If it is exceeds, then it's very difficult to know. Okay. No, this is 20 minutes. Okay. We'll continue with the another kind of instruction called as a branch control instructions. What exactly the branch control instructions are? Is a question. So the statement, let us go for the statement. Don't think that I am going to read the statement and leave the explanation. It is not like that, but let us read the statement first. Okay, now in this case, let us read the statement first. Okay, so we are having, the statement says that the set of instructions which transfers the execution control from a sequential of execution to some other location, either by checking or without checking any condition, are called as branch control instructions. Means whatever the execution we are having, so means you are writing one program. Let us suppose we have written one program which performs the addition of two numbers. You can take the 8085 also. Okay, now we have not started the instruction. Writing the program in the 8086 microprocessor. You just go back to your 8085. So you would have written the program to pick the largest number, to pick the smallest number, to perform the multiplication operation using the addition, to perform the division operation using the subtraction, all those things you would have done that one, right? So let us take one simple example. Okay, so you are taking one program which performs the addition of two numbers, You have written over a set of instructions. All those instructions are going to be executed by the microprocessor in the sequential order. Sequential order is nothing but first, it executes the first instruction. After that, the next instruction. After that, the next instruction. After that, the next instruction. And the last one is going to be the HALT, HLT. Okay. So, means that execution is called as the sequential execution. Actually, we are having the two types of executions in when we are writing, we are running the program. That depends on the type of the control, type of the compiler which we are using. One is a sequential execution. Another one is a concurrent execution. Sequential execution means execution of the second instruction is going to be done soon after the execution of the first instruction is over. Means after finishing the first instruction, then only it is able to execute the second instruction. After finishing the second, it is going to be execute the third instruction. But in case of the concurrent instruction execution is nothing but whenever the information is ready, randomly the a particular instruction which is waiting for something need to be happened. If that is happened, then definitely a particular instruction is going to be executed. Let us suppose fifth instruction is waiting for occurrence of the one variable. Okay, now. So first 1, 2, 3, 4 instructions are not waiting for that, but the fifth instruction is waiting. Then let us suppose during the execution of the first instruction, if at all some variable is available, then immediately it is going to execute the fifth instruction, not the it is not going to follow the sequential operation. Okay, now. So here, whatever the branch instruction we are having, these instructions are going to be divert the execution control, that is the sequential execution control, from one location to another location. Okay. So let us know that one. When they are diverting the execution control from one location to another location, that kind of instructions are called as a branch control instructions. Okay. That kind of instructions are called as a branch control instructions. We will see the with one program, no problem at all. So here, the branch control instruction means transferring the execution control from one location to another location. For example, what I'll do is I'll take one white window. I'm assuming that I'm having some program, move accumulator A. You would have, yeah, it's going to be the A, right? What I'll do is I'll take my simple program to perform the addition of two numbers in using the 8086 microprocessor. I'm just taking one value, one 8-bit value into the accumulator, and after that I'm taking another 8-bit value into the BL register, which is a 06H. After that I'm simply performing addition operation between the AL BL. Okay, I'm simply performing the addition operation between the AL and BL, and after that what I'll would like to do means I would like to jump the execution control. I would like to transfer the execution control from here to some other location. okay, now from here to some other location. So transferring the execution control from one location to another location is going to be done by checking the condition or without checking any condition. Let me take without checking any condition scenario. So I'll take one call instruction. So call instruction means I'm expecting that this is my main program and I would like to call the sub program in the main program case. Okay, now. So in the call instruction, I'm writing one syntax like this, 5000H. Means 5000H is nothing but it is the offset address in the code segment. I'm expecting that sub program is there in the 5000 memory location. So if you want to know more specific one, I'm expecting that this program is there in the 3000H memory location. I'm assuming that this program is there in the 3000 memory location and my sub program is there in the 5000 memory location. So after executing that one, I'll take one more instruction. I'm just performing some nasty things, or it is not the nasty, I'm just performing some unwanted things for the explanation point of view. What I'll do is I'll take sorry for that word. I'll copy my final result which is there in the call instruction into some other register. So I'm expecting that the move control T, I'm going to copy the move instruction. I'm reading AL value into the CL, simple case. And after that, I am terminating program. In order to terminate the program in the 8086 microprocessor, we are having the INT03H. So INT03H is nothing but it is a breakpoint, which is a software interrupt operation. We will see that one, the interrupt concept also. So here it is a INT03H. But here we are calling the subprogram now. So I'm expecting that subprogram is there in the 5000H memory location. Subprogram is there in the 5000H memory location, right? So let me try take 5000H. Memory location. So over here I'm expecting that my sub program is existed. So in the sub program I'm simply performing another random operation, so which is nothing but I'm just copying the one value into the AL register, which is a 02, and another value into the BL register, which is a, means if you are getting confused, then I'm going to take the BL register comma 03. And after that, so I forgot to write the H, so I'm sorry for that. So you are supposed to take the H. So H followed by, I'm just performing the multiplication operation, multiplication DL. I'm just performing the multiplication operation, which is nothing but the multiplication DL. So that multiplication is going to be done between the AL and DL, and final result is there in the X. We least bother about that one. So as we call the main sub program, I'm just returning from the sub program to the main program. Okay, now I'm just returning from the sub program to the main program. Look at this one. This execution is a sequential execution. So this is the main program and 5000H is a sub program. In the main program, first instruction got executed, means 03 is going to be saved into the AL. Second instruction got executed, 06 is going to be stored inside the BL. And we are performing the addition between the AL and BL. So obviously 9 is going to be stored inside the AL. After that, what we are doing is we are executing the call instruction. Okay, now call instruction means we are diverting, means we are calling the sub program which is there in the 5000H memory location. Okay, now calling the sub program is nothing but diverting the execution control from the main program to the sub program. From the main program to the sub program. Actually, the main program is there in the 3000H memory location, but sub program is there in the 5000H memory location. Sub program is there in the 5000H memory location. Okay, now. So once you use the call instruction, once the microprocessor executes the call instruction, so as the name says that calling the sub program, so it is going to be diverse the execution control from the main program to the sub program. Here, is the microprocessor is checking any condition to divert the execution control? No. It is simply by seeing the call instruction, it realizes that I need to transfer the execution control from the main program to the sub program. Okay. So this operation is called as a branch control instruction. Means control, branch control instructions are nothing but which transfers the execution control from one location to another location. Actually, soon after you finish the call instruction, you should get the execute the move instruction. But call instruction says that divert the execution control from the main program to the sub program. So this kind of operation is called as a branch control instruction. Means we are diverting the execution control of the microprocessor from the 3000H memory location main program to the 5000H sub program. But in the sub program, soon after you finish the RET instruction, RET says that again you are returning from the sub program to the main program. subprogram to the main program. This is also one of the branch control instruction. Means soon after, so after the RET, if at all you are having some other set of instructions, let us suppose I'm having the add instruction and I'm having the load S instruction, all those things. These instructions won't get executed because we are having the RET. As the RET says that return from the subroutine to the called program, which is nothing but the main program. So means without checking any condition, we are diverting the execution control from here to here. Okay, now we are diverting the execution control from here to here. This is the one kind of explanation for the branch control instructions. That too, under the branch control instruction, we are having the unconditional branch instruction, conditional branch instruction. Unconditional branch instructions are nothing but diverting the execution control from one location to another location without checking any condition. Diverting the execution control from one location to another location without any check, without checking any condition, are called as a unconditional branch instruction. So one of the example is a call instruction is a one of the example for the unconditional branch instruction. RET is a one of the example for the unconditional branch instruction. And another kind of instruction also we can take. So we are having one more instruction called as a JMP instruction, which is nothing but the jump, which is nothing but the jump. Okay. So we are having one more instruction called as a JMP instruction. Let me take the JMP also. So JMP is also diverting the execution control from one location to another location without checking any condition. That is going to be done within the same program. Call instruction is going to be divert the execution control from the main program to the subprogram. But the jump instruction is going to be done within the main, within the same program, within the same program. For that also we are having some conditions, but if I'm going to elaborate that explanation, you may get confused because we are having the jump followed by the address. That address should be there within the 64 kilo locations. At that time only it is able to divert the execution control. All those things, we have certain rules and regulations, but I'm not going to elaborate that explanation for your convenience. I'm just keeping that information. I'm going to say that only one thing, that JMP instruction is nothing but which is used as a unconditional branch instruction. We are having the conditional as well as the unconditional branch instruction. Let me take one simple example for the unconditional branch operation. So here what I'm going to do means I'm just performing the some operation move same. Let me take the same example 03H and then move DL comma 06H followed by add operation, add AL comma DL, and after that what I'm going to do means I'm simply performing the one simple operation. I'm simply jumping from the from this location to add operation. I'm simply performing every time using the label. Okay. I'm just taking the label over here. Let me take the red color. Okay, no problem. I'm not satisfied. Wait a minute. I'll take middle one, middle part. I'm just taking the two instructions. Move. Remember, my mnemonics and register name should be written in the capitals. We have the rules AL comma 03H DL comma 06H some numbers simple performing add space AL comma DL. After that I'm simply using the JMP instruction, JMP space label. Okay, I'm just taking my label. So I would like to repeat the add operation. I would like to repeat the add operation. For my convenient and for your convenient, I'm going to take the red mark to mention the label, right? Label full. Okay. So I'm repeating the add instruction using the JMP. I'm repeating add instruction using the JMP. And if you want, you can terminate the program with the rule INT 03H, which is the breakpoint actually. INT 03H, which is a breakpoint. Okay, if you see this one here, what we are doing, we are simply performing the move operation. After that, we are performing another move operation. After that, we are performing the add operation. Add operation means DL is added with the AL, and final result is there in the AL. And we are performing the JMP instruction, jump instruction. Jump means we are asking the microprocessor take the label address, label address, and jump to the specified label address. That label address is nothing but again the add operation location. So it is keep on jumping over here. So are we checking any condition over here? Whenever the JMP instruction got executed by the microprocessor, it simply transfers the execution control from the present location to the specified label address. You may use the label address over here or over here or over here, anywhere, but we have certain rule that is nothing but that label address should be there within the 64 kilo locations only, which in the 64 kilo location only, but I am not going to consider that point. So here it is going to be the label address, means without checking any condition, microprocessor is every time transferring its execution control from JMP instruction to the add instruction, JMP instruction to the add instruction. It is an unconditional jump instruction. It is one of the example for the branch control instruction. That too, unconditional branch instruction. Let us suppose we are having the conditional branch instruction. Okay. So conditional branch instructions are nothing but, so means they are going to be divert the execution control from one location to another location if at all certain conditions are going to be satisfied. If the condition is not satisfied, then definitely it is not going to be transfers the execution control to the specified label address. One of the example for the conditional branch instructions are the JA, JNB. Whatever the conditional branch instructions which we are having, they are working based on the conditional flags, like sign flag. I forgot to explain the flag register. Just remember that. Yeah, let me show you the some conditional flags what we are having. Conditional flags what we are having in 8086 microprocessor. Total 9 flags are 16 bit flag register. So let me take the flags. One is going to be the carry flag. Okay, carry flag, auxiliary carry flag, sign flag, zero flag, overflow flag, 5, right? And finally, the last one is going to be the parity flag. Total, how many flags are there? 6 flags are there. These are the flag bits which are there in the flag register of the 8086 microprocessor. These are the 6 conditional flags: carry flag, auxiliary carry flag, sign flag, zero flag, overflow flag, and the parity flag. We have 3 more flag registers, which are nothing but 3 are they? Okay, let me take the color change. These are the direction control flags. One is a DF direction control flag. Another one is a direction control and a trap flag, and interrupt. Final one is going to be the interrupt flag. We are having the IF. Okay. So total 9 flags are there in the flag register. Flag register size in the 8086 microprocessor is a 16 bit. Out of 16 bit, only the 9 bits are going to be used by the microprocessor. Rest of the remaining 7 bits are there, they are not defined bits. So D is nothing but the direction flag, T is nothing but the trap flag, I is nothing but the interrupt flag. Okay, na? So these are the control flags, and these are the conditional flags. 6 are the conditional flags, and 3 are the control flags. Okay, now we'll see all of them. But whatever the conditional branch instructions we are having under the branch control set, they are working based on the any one of these bit positions, any one of the conditional flags, which are nothing but the carry flag, auxiliary carry flag, sign flag, zero flag, overflow flag, and the parity flag. Any one of the depending on any one of these flag bit position, they are going to be divert the execution control from one location to another location, if you want to realize that one. So I'll take one simple example. For your convenient, I'm going to take a W. Okay. And diversion control, right? So I would like to compare the two instructions or two values, AL value, which is a 06H, and a BL value. Is going to be the 03H. Let me take the in reverse order. 03H, and after that I am going to use the CMP, compare instruction, comparing the AL value with the BL, comparing the AL value with the BL. I think we would have not covered the compare instruction. So compare instruction always compares the two operands. Means if you are going to the what is that syntax? So AL is going to be the destination, BL is going to be the source. AL is going to be the destination, BL is going to be the source. And I think we are supposed to elaborate the compare instruction, then only you can realize this concept. Okay, compare instruction, I think we would have not covered that compare operation. So what we do is we are having the compare operation. Okay, so we are having the compare instruction. Compare instruction is always performs the comparison between the two operands. One is the destination and source. If you want the detailed one, let me take the CMP, which is nothing but the syntax. Compare destination. Sorry, syntax. I'm just taking the destination comma source because we would have not covered this particular instruction. So compare is nothing but it is going to be compares the source value with the destination. How it is going to be compares the source value with the destination means by subtracting the source from the destination. Upon executing the above instruction, the microprocessor is subtracting the source value from the destination. After subtracting the source value from the destination, we are getting some result now. So I'm just taking the R. So the result is not going to be stored in the destination. Here it is not the case. I'm just taking one R variable. So assume that R is holding the result of this subtraction. Okay. So it is subtracting the source from the destination and stores the result. Based on this particular result, it is going to be updates the conditional flags. Like carry flag, sign flag, zero flag, parity flag, overflow flag, and the sign flag, zero flag, carry flag, auxiliary carry flag. Okay, now. So means it is going to be update all the conditional flags based on this result. But the result is not going to be stored. It is not means the compare instruction is not disturbing the content of the destination and not disturbing the content of the source. But after performing the subtraction operation, whatever the result we are getting, based on this result, it is going to be updates all the conditional flags. Based on this result, based on the subtraction result of this particular operation, based on that, it is updating all the conditional flags. That's it. But it is not changing the content of the source as well as the content of the destination. For example, we are taking the move AL, BL. So in this case, it is going to be subtract. Means it is performing the, it is subtracting the AL value, BL value from the AL. It is subtracting the AL value from the, BL value from the A. It is subtracting the here. BL value from the A. It is subtracting the BL value from the A. Okay. So after subtraction, what is there? In general, we are expecting that AL value is going to be the 03, but it is not like that. After subtraction, AL is going to be the AL is equals to 06 only. And BL is going to 03 only. These values are not changing. AL value is not changing. BL value is not changing. But this subtraction result is how much? This subtraction result. So AL minus BL na? AL minus BL means it is subtracting 06 minus 03. It is performing the 06 minus 03. The result is what? 03. We are not saving the result anywhere. We are not saving this particular result anywhere. But based on this result, it is going to be updates all the conditional flags. Means it is saying that the compare instruction majorly it is comparing the two operands. Compare operation means actually it is updating the required flags. Not all the conditional flags actually. Only few flags are there. So if you want to know those are few flags specific one, we will come to that one. Comparing is nothing but what? Why we are going to perform the compare operation? We would like to know that whether the destination is greater than the source, destination is less than the source, destination is equal to the source. Comparison means whether a particular person is taller than some person, or both are equal in height, or smaller than the some other person. Means comparison is always to do to check it out whether both are equal or any one of them is greater than. any one of them is greater. So that result is going to be specified by the compare instruction. Means it is subtracting the source value from the destination, and after performing this operation, based on the result, it is going to be justifies that whether the destination is greater than the source, whether the destination is less than the source, whether the destination is equal to the source. But it is not affecting the content of the destination as well as the source. It is not changing the values of the destination as well as the source, which are participating in as a part of the CMP instruction, but it is going to be gives the result whether the destination is greater than the source, destination is less than the source, or destination is equal to the source. Means three conditions are it is going to be specifies. Soon after this instruction got executed, it is going to be mentions whether CMP instruction, right? CMP instruction comparing the destination source by source by subtracting. As we know that it is subtraction, but after comparison, what kind of result it is going to be get? Whether the destination is greater than source, destination is greater than source, or destination is less than source, or destination is equals to the source. These three conditions are going to be mentioned by the CMP instruction. It is going to be done based on the by subtracting the source from the destination. It will update the some conditional flags. Based on those conditional flags, we can check it out that whether the destination is greater than source, destination is less than source, destination is equals to the source. So those conditional flags are nothing but I'm just taking blue color. Okay, so if the destination is greater than source, then the carry flag, we are having the carry flag now. Destination is greater than source now. What kind of operation we are performing actually? This CMP instruction is performing subtracting source from the destination. So after subtraction, check it out whether the destination is greater than the source. So here, if the destination is greater than the source in the subtraction, is it necessary to take any borrow? No. So that's why the CF flag is going to be zero. CF flag equals to the zero, and CF flag is equals to the zero, and zero flag, we have the zero flag also. Zero flag equals to the zero, because it is a non-zero value. Result of this one, both are not equal. If both are not equal, then means if we are reading the condition, if soon after executing this instruction, if we are reading the condition, means if we are reading this, sorry. Shit. So we have the CMP instruction. Come on, man. CMP instruction. We have the CMP. Followed by destination, comma. Give me some time. Source. Okay. We have some destination source. No, I'm not satisfied with this. Destination source. So it is performing. When it is performing the destination source operation, so it is nothing but simply destination. Means the source value subtracted from the destination. So based on this, the compare instruction, it is going to be takes the judgment. It is showing that whether the destination is greater than source, or destination is less than source, or destination is greater than So destination is equals to the source. If at all the destination is greater than source, means when you are performing the comparator operation. If at all the destination is greater than source, it is showing that destination is greater than source by using the two flags. One is carry flag, sorry, one is the carry flag. I'll take the red color. Okay, red color. So if the destination is greater than source, then the carry flag equals to the zero. Sorry, carry flag equals to zero, and also the zero flag equals to the zero. So if the carry flag and zero flag both are zeros, then the destination is greater than source. Means after performing the after performing the compare operation, if at all you are reading the carry flag equals to the zero, zero flag equals to zero, then the microprocessor is saying that the destination is greater than the source. Destination is greater than the source. Comparison is done by subtracting the source value from the destination. If at all the destination is less than the source, then the CF, whatever the CF we are having now, CF equals to the 1. And CF equals to the 1 and zero flag equals to the 0. Zero flag equals to the 0. If these two conditions are satisfied, then we can say that the destination is less than the source. The destination is less than the source. Okay, now the destination is less than the source. If the destination and source both are equal, then what will happen? If both are equal, then the carry flag equals, no need to take the carry now. So carry flag equals to the 0 and zero flag equals to the 1, because the result of that subtraction. So here the subtraction, based on the subtraction only it is giving the result. Na? Result of this subtraction, if both are equal, obviously 0. So 0 flag equals to the 1. So this means the microprocessor, upon executing the compare instruction, microprocessor is going to be updates the some conditional flags, but out of them we are simply taking the carry flag and the 0 flag. If the carry flag, 0 flag both are equal to 0, then the destination is obviously greater than source. If the carry flag equals to the 1 and 0 flag is equals to the 0, obviously the destination is less than the source. If the carry flag is equals to the 0 and the 0 flag equals to the 1, obviously destination equals to the source. Destination is equals to the source. Okay, now. So I think actually we draw back to this explanation, compare instruction explanation in conditional branch instructions case. So what we do is we'll continue the conditional branch instructions. You just remember this particular compare instruction. So during the conditional branch instruction, we are going to use some conditional instructions, simple instructions like JC, JNC and like that. So that's why I gave the explanation of this instruction. Actually, this one should be given in the mathematical arithmetical instructions part. So just remember the compare instruction. We'll continue the branch control instructions, that too, the conditional branch instructions in the next coming class. Okay, I think the class is exceeded. I think it is almost 1 hour. So we'll continue in the next class with conditional branch instruction and other categories which are there in the instruction set of the 8086 microprocessor. That's all for today's class. We'll continue in the next class. I think audio is not good. I kept the hand on the microphone. Okay. We'll continue in the next class with the conditional branch instructions. Okay. That's all for today's class. If you're having any queries regarding this one, let me know in the WhatsApp group. Okay. So just note down this point. We'll continue in the next class with another kind of explanation. Okay. That is nothing but the conditional branch instructions. Okay. That's all for today's class. We'll continue in the next class. Thank you.